Hello, church. Let me be the first to welcome you here today. We're so glad you decided to join us. Make sure you share this service with all of your friends by clicking the share arrow at the bottom right-hand side of your screen on Facebook so that all your friends know the amazing stuff we're doing here at Cresthill. If this is your first time joining us, make sure you say hi in the chat so that we can welcome you and so that we know you're here. We know you're not here by mistake and that you clicked on this worship service today for a reason. So wherever you are, in the kitchen, in the living room, even in your PJs in the bedroom, or at Cresthill, let's worship together.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship.
Hello, church. Welcome. We're glad you guys have joined us together, both here on campus and live, wherever you might be worshiping with us today. Today's going to be a great day of celebration as we continue to worship God. We're going to be in the waters today. We're having our pool party, and we're just celebrating today. So we're going to start out worshiping together. If you're here, stand up. Home, you can stand up, worship with us as we celebrate Jesus here this morning.
Thank you.
had to move out of the way there. Taylor was going to kick me, I think, but praise God. You know, we have so much to celebrate. We're celebrating God changing lives together as we're in the waters today, the process of the testimony of baptism. We're celebrating the justice and love of God. Today's Juneteenth, so happy Juneteenth, everyone. And God celebrates any time we go from bondage to freedom. So I think God's all in that. We are too here at Cresthill Church, and celebrating the testimony of Brother Dick preaching today, or one of our lay pastors, and just continue to just love Jesus as we praise and worship Him. We're going to sing Praise Adonai. Praise to God as we sing. We join together, we gather together to praise His name together. Praise God.
We lift our voice, we lift our hearts.
Good morning, Cresthill Church. How are you today? Amen. What a great day. Beautiful weather outside. Great day to be in the house of the Lord, to worship and pray and just gather together. But you want to know something? I was thinking that earlier. What a great day to be in the house of the Lord. It's a beautiful day outside. But even if there was a snowstorm out there or a rainstorm out there, it's still a great day when you're inside the house of the Lord, gathered together to pray. Amen. Give God some glory for that. And today being Father's Day, how appropriate that we can gather and worship and praise our Heavenly Father. Happy Father's Day to all the dads out there. Yeah. I just love being in the house of the Lord, getting together with God's people. And we had a great time last night at the ball game, reaching people and just expanding the gospel to whoever we came into contact with. So whenever God's people get together, there's a party going on, and today it's going to be a pool party. Praise God for that. Hallelujah. Well, as we get ready for a special message today from lay pastor Dick Stone, we're going to prepare our hearts. So let's go to our Heavenly Father in prayer and prepare our hearts to receive the message He has for us today. Heavenly Father, we just praise You and thank You that You love us, that You are our Heavenly Father, that we can come to You with our needs, with our hurts, and even come to You with our praise when things are good. You are always there for us. We praise You for being with us. And Father, at this time, I ask that You prepare our hearts and our minds to receive the message You have for us today. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I ask that You let Your Holy Spirit loose in this house. Let every heart be touched. Let every heart be drawn closer to You. For those that don't know You, soften their hearts and open their minds and draw them to You. For those of us that do know You, make this a wonderful day of rejoicing in the name of the Lord. And Father God, we ask all of this in Jesus' name, giving You praise and glory and honor. Amen and amen.
I'm Dick Stone, and Jimmy asked me to preach this weekend. He's taking a break and is in Ocean City, spending time at the beach with Margo, which is great for him, well-deserved. I do not have a Hawaiian shirt like a lot of the other guys here, but I do have a special Father's Day shirt on. It says, "Awesome dads grow beards and are well-read in scripture and theology." So anyway, when Jimmy asked me if I'd ever want to preach again, I told him, yes, I would. One thing I've discovered is if the Lord tells you to do something, you don't run from it like Jonah did. Jimmy has often said from this pulpit that he is an introvert. I, too, am an introvert, but I also have social anxiety. So the fact that I'm up here to deliver another sermon for the second time tells you all you need to know about the power of the Holy Spirit. Since Jimmy isn't here today, I thought I would share a story about the first time I met with him one-on-one. I had been attending Cresthill for a few months and wanted to meet with him to discuss becoming a member of the church. As I sat in Jimmy's office in the annex next door, I noticed one thing, a copy of Eric Clapton's autobiography on his bookshelf. This told me two things. Not only did we both love Jesus, but we had an affinity towards guitars and the blues. Which leads me to the subject of today's message, how Christians can beat the blues. Psalm 42:5 reads, "Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil within me? Hope in God, for I shall praise Him again, my salvation." The book of Psalms is an amazing book. It is the hymnal of the Old Testament Jews, but it is so much more than that. Yes, the Psalms are filled with glorious praise to the Lord God Almighty, but is also filled with the raw emotion of those who are struggling and wondering where God is. You can cry out to the Lord in your pain and your frustration, and He sees you, and He hears you. We all have seasons in our lives when we can get down in the dumps. Just about anything in this world can get us down. You could be having difficulty on your job, have an argument with someone close to you, or all you have to do is turn on the news and see what's going on in the world, and that'll depress you for sure. Well, if that happens to you, then baby, you got the blues. But thankfully, the Bible gives us the remedies we need to beat the blues. The first thing that Christians can do to beat the blues is believe the positive. Philippians 4:8 reads, "Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things." All too often, many Christians believe negatives rather than positives. They look for and concentrate on the bad things that happen instead of the good things that happen. Do any of us know anybody like that? How many of us have been guilty of it ourselves? I know I have. The thing is, we need to dwell on the positives and look for the good in others and in circumstances. Country music legend, the late Kenny Rogers, sang a song called "The Greatest." A lot of us who grew up playing baseball and we didn't have enough people to have field two teams, we'd go out to the field, a few of us. One person would take the ball and the bat. He'd toss it up in the air, and as the ball's coming down, he'd swing the bat and hit it to the other people in the field. Well, in the first verse of the song, we are introduced to a little boy in a baseball cap. The boy says, "I am the greatest player of them all." Then he puts his bat on his shoulder, he tosses up the ball, and the chorus goes, "And the ball goes up, the ball comes down. He swings his bat all the way around. The world's so still he can hear the sound as the baseball falls to the ground." He's not deterred, though. He repeats it, that he is the greatest, and he does it again. Tosses the ball up, swings, and misses. Strike two. Verse 3 gives us the same result. Strike 3, you're out. The song ends with the boy's mother calling him home for dinner. He heads home and says, "I am the greatest, that is a fact. But even I didn't know I could pitch like that." Now that is somebody who dwells on the positive. After we believe the positive, we need to look for the purpose. Romans 8:28 tells us, "And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose." Everything that happens to us in our lives has a divine purpose, and we need to look for that purpose to have victory over discouragement. You ever look back on things that happened in your life, and suddenly, like a flash of lightning, you realize that God was there, and he intervened? Maybe not like we had hoped, but ultimately for our good. I remember one time at a job, there was an opportunity for a promotion, and I really wanted that job. I felt that I'd worked hard, and I deserved the opportunity. Unfortunately, I didn't even get a chance to interview for the position, as they hired someone from outside the company. As it turned out, it ended up being a blessing from God. When my new boss took over, I saw the things that the company was putting her through and knew if it had been me that I would have been miserable. Truly, that was a providential blessing from God, but at first, I couldn't see it. Looking back, I can see God's purpose in saying no to my prayers. I know many of us have one of these, and this technology can be both good and bad. I find myself wasting a lot of time scrolling through social media and playing games on my phone. But the best thing about that technology is using the Bible app that I have. Every morning I get up and read one of several devotionals that I'm going through. There are several different versions of the Bible that you can read. So every time Jimmy changes from the NIV to the Message to any of the other versions, I can follow along with him pretty quickly. One of the reading plans that I was reading through when I started writing this sermon was one written by Charles Stanley called Passion and Purpose. On the first day of the plan, Stanley writes, "The truth is, it's easy to find ourselves settled and complacent in life. And there are many reasons we can feel stuck and discouraged or adrift, lose our enthusiasm for life, and forfeit our hope, sense of purpose, and peace. Again, this is Stanley speaking. In my opinion, the foremost reasons are because many people have lost sight of who God made them to be and what He designed them to do. As a result, countless people are not actively, intentionally, and purposefully pursuing what the Father has planned for them. If you truly want to pursue your purpose and reach your full potential in life, then you must face up to these two truths. Truth one, God has placed more within you than you realize. Let that sink in for a moment. God has placed more within you than you realize. Stanley goes on to write, truth two, you likely have settled for the life you're living now. You must remember that your Heavenly Father sees you through the eyes of love and forgiveness. He sees you where you are, but He also sees the person He made you to be. God sees all the awesome potential and possibilities He's created you to fill. If you're willing to discover and align yourself with His plan and purpose for you, He'll bless you more than you could ever imagine and open doors of opportunities you never dreamed possible. He'll restore the joy, peace, and hope you've lost and show the path to the accomplishment He wants in your life. And He promises to bless you with life at its best. God has placed you here in this time and in this location to allow you to maximize your role in establishing His will on earth as it is in heaven. If you ever wonder why you're on this earth, understand that God has placed you here as a unique person with a unique mission aimed at establishing and extending His kingdom. And your potential lies securely and completely in that purpose. After we look for the purpose, we must utilize the promises. Numbers 23:19 gives us this truth. God is not man that He should lie, or a son of man that He should change His mind. Has He said and will He not do it? Or has He spoken and will He not fulfill it? Our God is a promise-keeping God. When God makes a promise, you can rest assured that it will come to pass. The promises of God go way deeper than a simple agreement between two parties. God enters a covenant with His people. In the ancient Near East and Greco-Roman culture, a covenant was a sacred kinship bond between two parties, ratified by the swearing of an oath. Throughout Scripture, in every period of salvation, God establishes covenants. In Genesis 9, 8 through 17, God establishes a covenant with Noah and his sons, promising to never destroy all living things through a flood again. And the rainbow will be a reminder of that covenant. Genesis 15, 1 through 21, God establishes a covenant with Abram, later to be called Abraham, promising that even though Abram and Sarai were childless in their advanced years, God will give him an offspring as numerous as the stars in the sky. And in the New Testament, Jesus establishes a new covenant with the establishment of the Lord's Supper and the breaking of bread and wine. Clement of Rome had this to say about the blessed promises of God. How blessed and wonderful are the gifts of God, beloved. Life and immortality, splendor and righteousness, truth with boldness, faith with confidence, self-control and holiness. All these things fall within our comprehension. Therefore, what, then, are the things being prepared for those who wait? The Creator and Father of the ages, the All-Holy One Himself, knows their magnitude and beauty. Therefore, let us strive to be found among the number of those who wait, so that we may share in the gifts which were promised. When we fall into difficult times, it's hard to focus on the promises of God, but it is precisely at those times that we must focus on God's promises. If we don't, we risk missing out on the benefits promised in God's word. Let me share an example of a family who is facing difficult times. In 1979, Verna Bowman of Telford, Pennsylvania, gave birth to her fourth child, Jeff, and quickly learned from doctors the frightening news. The baby had defective kidneys. Writing in guideposts, she tells that doctors ordered the child rushed to a children's hospital in Philadelphia, where he would receive kidney dialysis. still hospitalized yourself. Can you imagine that? You've just welcomed a new life into your family. You can't celebrate because that newborn child has a devastating medical condition. Worse yet, as the mother, your baby's taken away to another hospital while you stay where you are to recover from the rigors of childbirth. Continuing with the story, Verna prayed and prayed for her son, and as she did, she soon felt God's nearness. Excuse me. The words of a scripture text began to repeat at her heart. This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, John 11:4. She wrote the words down. Later, her husband called to report on the baby's condition. It's too soon to tell if he's going to make it. He's going to make it, Verna replied, and she read him that verse that God had given to her, and she says, I believe those words. He said, so do I, Verna, so do I. After 3 months of dialysis, Jeff's kidneys, though still defective, began to function on their own. Throughout his childhood, Jeff took medication and tired easily. And during that time, Verna collected in her journal other scriptures which encouraged her faith that her son would be all right. When Jeff was 13, the doctors reported he would need a transplant. Though unsettling at first, the news turned out to be the answer to her prayers. Verna herself provided the kidney, and the operation was a complete success, and Jeff would go on to live a normal life. Later, Verna's daughter suggested they do something special with the scriptures that had meant so much to them during Jeff's long sickness. Verna often made quilts, and her daughter was skilled at cross stitch. So they decided to make a quilt that displayed 12 of the cherished promises from the Bible. Each scripture was stitched onto white linen and bordered in a pattern of hunter green and burgundy. 3 months later, the quilt was complete and hung on the wall in their guest room. When others admired the quilt, it eventually was hung in their church, as well as other churches in the area. God's promises had made a great difference for Verna Bowman. When she chose to have these promises stitched onto a quilt, she made a fitting choice. As comforting as a quilt on a cold wintry night, so God's promises ward off soul-chilling fear. They warm the soul. The fourth thing that we can do to beat the blues is encourage other people. Hebrews 10:23-25. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. Let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. We are called to be an encouragement to one another. When we encourage other people, we lift them up and give them hope. The opposite of encourage is to discourage, and when we discourage people, we push them down and take away their hope. I'd like to share two personal stories, one positive and one negative, about encouragement. The first church that I belonged to had a small but very active college career group that I was a part of. We did street ministry downtown on the 4th of July. We sang in the choir, and we even had a ministry at nursing homes. During that time, I switched jobs. I went from making $5 an hour to more than doubling it. After working there a couple of months, the company said they were closing all of their stores. The night they told me it would be my last night, I left the store dejected. I put my key in the ignition of my car, and it wouldn't start. Dead battery. My dad came out and jump-started my car. In my discouragement, I stopped at a liquor store and bought a six-pack of beer. Later, I was speaking with a close friend in the group and told her everything that had happened. But when I told her about the beer, her response was, "Oh, Richard," like I had committed a heinous act. I never set foot in that church again. Part of that was my own spiritual immaturity as a young Christian, but at a time when I could really use encouragement, I received judgment and condemnation. Fast forward about 40 years. During the COVID pandemic, I lost a good job. It took a while, almost 2 years, but I eventually found a new job. During this season in my life, I had the opportunity to spend a lot of time with Pastor Jimmy. We would get together for coffee and just talk. We talked about music, the state of affairs in this country, politics, and the books we read. During that time, we weren't pastor and congregant, we were friends. Jimmy showed genuine concern for the things my wife and I were going through. He assured me that God had greater plans for me and would not just give me a job, but he would give me the perfect job in his timing. Through those conversations, Jimmy asked me if I ever considered teaching and if I ever considered preaching. The answer to both those questions was a resounding yes. Through Jimmy's encouragement has helped me find my purpose in serving God. The final thing we need to do to beat the blues is sing God's praises. Psalm 148, 3 through 4 reads, "Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens, and you waters above the heavens." Did you know that stars sing? It's true. Go onto YouTube and search for singing stars, and you can hear it for yourself. How do we know this? Pastor Louis Giglio and Matt Redman wrote an amazing book titled Indescribable. It is a book that displays how science and the universe display the glory, power, and majesty of God. NASA has a program called SETI, which is a search for extraterrestrial intelligence. Science believed that if we were to ever find other life forms out there, they would find them near other stars like our sun and would communicate via radio waves. Giglio writes, "We know stars sing because in our quest to search for extraterrestrial life or intelligence, we have spent a great deal of time listening to the skies. Large radio telescopes aimed at stars have captured some phenomenal results, including the sounds of the first singing star that he ever saw, the Vela Pulsar. 800 light years from Earth, the Vela Pulsar is a highly magnetized neutron star. Exploding into a supernova at death, the Vela collapsed back on itself as a magnetic entity with the force that causes it to rotate 10 times per second on its axis. As it rotates, a radio frequency is emitted. While the whirling Vela is striking to look at, it's incredible to hear as it makes its rhythmic staccato beat nonstop, a sound we can hear after it travels 800 times 5.8 trillion miles. But as the Vela taps out a steady beat, other millisecond pulsars hum with the sounds of violins playing in various octaves. 47 Tucanae, some 16,700 light years away, is a globular cluster containing dense concentration of super bright stars. Among them are 23 millisecond pulsars, 16 of which have been recorded. Imagine 16 stringed instruments tuning and playing sustained notes on a massive scale. Who knew God had his own string section? Most scholars believe the book of Psalms was written between 1500 BC and 600 BC. 3,000 years ago, the psalmist knew what scientists discovered in the last century. If the stars in the heavens can sing their praises to the Lord, so can we. Psalm 66, 1 and 2. "Shout for joy to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise." Sometimes Christians fail to praise the Lord enough. Praising God brings hope. It helps lift us out of despair. Rich Mullins wrote a song that Amy Grant recorded called "Sing Your Praise to the Lord." The chorus goes, "Sing your praise to the Lord. Come on, everybody. Stand up and sing one more hallelujah. Sing your praise to the Lord. I can never tell you how much good that it's going to do you. It's just to sing your praise to the Lord." So sing your praises to the Lord. It'll do you good. So when we have the blues, we know what to do. We must believe the positive, look for the purpose, utilize the promises, encourage other people, and sing God's praises. So now I ask you, how are you feeling now?
Wow, do you feel that? Do you feel God tugging at your heartstrings? If you want a relationship with Jesus, you don't get it by watching us. You don't get it by rules or rituals. If you want a relationship with Jesus, pray this with me right now. Jesus, come into my heart. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. God, I give you my life. I give you total control of my life. I believe you are who you say you are, and I believe everything the Bible said you did. I ask you to come into my life. I know that I'm a sinner, and I ask for forgiveness today. I want to trust to follow you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. If you pray that, God just came into your heart to live inside of you. I want you to go right now to Cresthill.org/connect to tell us about the decision you just made so that we can celebrate with you. If you're looking for a church home, become a part of our Cresthill family by going to Cresthill.org/connect today. With your giving, Cresthill is able to serve our community, baptize people, and spread the message of Jesus across the globe, just like we're doing right now online. If you'd like to help us spread the message of Jesus, go to Cresthill.org/give to do just that. Help us spread the message of Jesus across the globe. God bless you. I want to invite you to come next week. Matter of fact, don't just come by yourself. Have a watch party with all of your friends so that all of you can praise God together. We thank you for joining us. See you next week. If you need prayer, go to Cresthill.org/prayer and put your prayer request on the prayer wall so that we can pray for you. So lastly, we love you. God loves you. Never give up, never give in. And as always, keep the faith.